Just a reminder that PCBWay is having a sale this Christmas. It continues right through to the 30th, and there are coupons available on their website. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review of the AdonStar AD207 digital microscope. So I'll place a little time code over here so you can jump straight to where I start the review, but there'll be a little bit of a preamble while I just discuss why I picked this out for review. Now, I receive probably over 100 emails a month, and my channel is still relatively small. It would be far greater for the large channels of companies wanting me to review their bits and pieces. And they range from the cheapest of the cheap to perhaps some nicer pieces of equipment. So I certainly have to be, and I've become very selective in what I want to review. The criteria is, does it take my fancy? Am I really interested in this piece of equipment? Or, hey, actually I don't have that, and that would be really useful on my bench. And the latter is why I picked this device. I don't have a digital microscope per se. I do have an AM scope, which is more for optical use, using kind of binocular view with higher magnification. That's a more specialized use. It does have a camera built into it, but that camera doesn't have the resolution of this device. This is full HD, and I have to connect to a laptop, whereas this, you've got a nice 7-inch screen with a high definition display. It can take pictures and video. I have got magnifying glasses scattered around here because as I entered my 40s, probably like many other folks, the eyes don't focus as well, and I need reading glasses. So I'm constantly either reaching for glasses or needing a magnifying glass. And in particular, when I'm doing some soldering at the bench, I've got a magnified lamp which I can pull down, put down in front of me, so that I can magnify the work in front of me to make it easier to work on. When I'm demonstrating things on the bench and I want to get in close, I have been using the AM scope, but this, I think, is going to replace it now. So let's get down to the bench and take a closer look at it. Okay, so before we take a physical look at the device, I'll just quickly show you the specifications. It notes that it's got the image sensor is 2 megapixels. It can do both 1080 and 720 at 30 frames per second. You've got the video format. It says up to 100 times magnification. It does have some digital magnification and optical. We'll have a look at that when we test it. I'll note the one thing is that if you go onto Amazon, and there are a ream of people trying to sell these devices, many of them are making crazy claims like 1,000 times or 3,000 times magnification. I can't verify that they're right or wrong, but it seems off the mark. It gives you the photo resolution. It's in a JPEG format. It gives you the focal range. I've only found really one issue with this, which I'll talk about in terms of the focal range. We've got the frame rate. You can restore things on a micro SD card up to 32 gig. It's got the power source and then the sizes. And then the display is a 7-inch display. Righty-ho, so excuse some of the reflection and glare. We'll get rid of that when we're actually operating this device. It's a little bigger, so it's a little difficult to get in frame. A couple of things I want to point out. For one, it was actually the company, and I think it's AdonStar, not sure how to pronounce this, they actually sent this to me. It wasn't a reseller. So I'm chuffed about that, because there's certainly one bit of feedback I'm going to provide, and hopefully they'll pick up from this video, where they could make a small improvement. And there's a good chance that because they're not a reseller, the actual company that produced this, that kind of thing can happen. If you certainly see things or have comments about this, then post them below, because I'm pretty sure they'll look at the comments. So this is the actual device. A couple of things I want to note in terms of the state I received this in, and certainly not a fault of the company. They sent this to me from Amazon. This was in its own box, and then Amazon placed this in a bigger box, a far bigger box, but with no other cushioning. So this was smashing around in that other box. Their box was damaged. One of the adjustments, you can see at the top here, you can adjust the height up and down to the table. One of the little adjusting wheels actually sheared off in that process, and you can see it got some scratches on the base over here. Not serious, it is still functional, but yeah, a little poke at Amazon, in this case for certainly not packaging something correctly. So we've got the kind of video screen and the video microscope camera housed in this one unit. It simply slides into and is clamped into this top little arm over here. We've then got this aluminium base with these little hole doors. If you want to hold a PC board on here or whatever you're viewing, you can do that. Or like for instance, when I show you, I'm gonna show you a wristwatch, I'll push them to the side. The camera itself is focused with this ring over here. It's actually got a really nice smooth action, and it is fine enough that it's easy enough to adjust. I'm going to show you, that's one of the things where you could go wrong, is where you cannot finally adjust this, but it is good enough. I will say that there might be the slightest little bit of play, so when you focus and you go back, it moves a little bit before it picks up again. You've then got the unit down here which has got a little glass lens to protect the screen, and they say to block some UV. It also has, you'll see in there, some LED lights. It has the capability to tilt, so I'll just tilt this, and that allows you to have something on the deck and view it from a different angle. So they kind of, the one thing they kind of note is a 3D effect, and I assume that's what they mean, unless it's just a marketing term. But if you tilt this away, then you, instead of looking straight down and perhaps getting a more flat two-dimensional view, if you tilt this back, you will get a more aspect 3D look. Although remember, it's not a binocular, you're just getting a different perspective looking at your area of interest over here, or your device of interest. It then does have these very handy LED lights on here. The brightness of these and the camera can be adjusted. I'm going to show you the connection at the moment. So many of these, so just note that if you are looking for these, because ours kind of, the price point for these kinds of devices goes from like $50 all the way up to several hundred dollars. This one costs about $160, and I was trying to look at it and say and justify why this cost more than, let's say, a $50 unit. For one, it's got the two lights on here, and it's got the full HD, and it's got the 7-inch display. So just note that if you are hunting around, if you're trying to do comparisons, note the size of the display. Does it do video? Does it take pictures? Does it have lights so you can illuminate this area over here? Then at the top of the unit here, we've got a USB connection, which is the power for this, and then you've got your SD card, which is inserted over here. I've got a 32 gig card, which I think is the maximum size that you can have. This, the display does tilt, so if you've moved the angle of the arm, you can adjust the angle of the display as well. At the back here, you'll see there's a separate power input to power these two lights. It is powered from a USB plug. They supply this USB power adapter over here. I can't vouch for the necessarily the quality of it. There are two plugs. You've got the DC plug to power the two lights, and then the USB connector to power the actual scope itself. You've got this little control on that to actually power everything on and off, and then adjust the brightness of the two LED lights. Okay, so I'm pulling you right back here just so that you can get everything in view. I've got a wristwatch down there at the moment, which is what you're seeing in the display. Let's pull this up slightly. I want to show you a few bits and pieces before I forget. Last but not least, it comes with this remote. And initially when I saw the remote, I thought, a gimmick, why do you need a remote? I was so wrong. You can control the camera, taking photographs, the sharpness, all the features of this without having to touch these buttons. And of course, when you've got something in focus, if you go and push on here, you're going to be bumping this and moving things around. So it's perfect having a remote to activate either a recording or take a picture. Anyway, let me first show you the speed at which it boots up at. So I'm going to power everything off. There you go. So everything's off and on. You see the light came on and it says welcome, and bang, the image is up. So that happens very quickly, and it has a very nice crisp display. I was very surprised to see this. I mean, I've got the watch in focus here. What I'm going to show you, I'm actually going to disconnect. You can see I have the two LED lights here, and their focal point is actually not on the wristwatch itself. I'm going to disconnect those so we can just see what the light from the scope does. In fact, what I'll do, I'll switch the light off my bench, So that we've only got that. So we've got the light over here, and there's a little thumb wheel. And you can see, as I touch this, this is what happens. You're going to get movement, right? But there you go. You can see you've got a light which you can adjust. Now, there's an interesting catch to this light, particularly when if you're working with wristwatches, right? You've got the glass in there, and if I come up to a certain angle, you get the lights reflecting in the crystal of the wristwatch. So actually being able to lean this over a little bit so you can move that reflection out the way and then take the capture whatever you're working on at a slight angle, for me, is really handy. If you're working with PCBs, it's a different story. You're not going to get that reflection. But I'm going to show you particularly my use case for looking at wristwatches, and then we'll have a look at a PCB. Okay, so next let me plug in the lights. Bang, so those are on. And you can then, you've got these nice flexible arms, so you can go and move these around, and you can see in the video. Now the one thing you need to be aware of is that sometimes you can have too much light down here, and you might not be able to see things as clearly as you might think. Well, when we get to the little PCB, I'll demonstrate that to you. But at least you can move them around, you can add the light, you can change the angle that they're at, so that you get a good clear display with the light where you need it. I say it can be a bit of a juggle, but at least these arms are long enough and they provide that flexibility to do that. Now let me just show you some of the basic focusing, and also at some point I'll pop up a captured video, because obviously you're not going to see the true resolution, or perhaps you will. I must say this is really crisp. That's the one thing that really has caught my eye. So I've got my wristwatch over here, and the one thing I really like, or that's going to be handy for me particularly with studying wristwatches, is for one, to see the fine detail on the face. Now look at this hand as it goes by. You can see this easily. Can you see that movement, how it's like bobbing about sometimes? Just wait, there we go, wiggle. That is the slop in the gearing of this wristwatch. And there's some interesting pros and cons to having a bit of slop in a wristwatch gearing, but having a device like this allows me to film that, capture that for different wristwatches, so that I can talk about that, I say, in coming videos. The focus wheel, so let me just take this out of focus. Now, I put a little mark on this focus wheel, and if I bring it right up, so at this point, this would be if I had it dropped right down, and it is only actually a half turn before I get something in focus over here. There is still, I think, 1.5 turns where if I was moving this up, I could bring something in focus. And that would mean that I could see more of the wristwatch face. And that's my perhaps only real complaint about this. The length of the arm at the back of this device is fairly short, but they've got a really nice focal length. I could have this whole wristwatch face in focus, and let's say if I had a PCB on there, more of it in focus, if only this could go higher up. Now let me take it down so we can see how close we can go. Now as I do this, I'm showing you the whole process. There is a thumb screw at the back to loosen the mechanism. And then you've got that little wheel, of which is only one left, where you can then take the camera down to get a closer view. And obviously as you do that, it goes out of focus. Now what you perhaps not quite seeing, there is a little bit of vibration. I reckon like a little bit of grease on the cog, which is lowering this, would make it just a little bit smoother. It's not bad. It's certainly not bad at all. But there. You can hear that. As I bring it down, it does do a little bit of a vibration. I think if there was some grease on there, it would kind of smooth out that little trip down. Right, so I'm going to bring this right down. Let me just bring things into focus. There we go. See, that's a fair bit closer. Go a bit further down. And you can see that big bright spot, that is the LED underneath. Oops, I should have locked it. Once you get it in place, you need to turn the lock screw so that it doesn't slip up and down. And now I'm going to tilt this back. And there we go. As I tilt the whole arm back, you can see I removed that LED, which was the problem. And then I can bring things back into focus again. And as you can see, it is actually very easy to get quite fine adjustment with this. Well, I'm there focusing on the hand as it goes by, or just a little bit sharper to the 12 o'clock index marker over there. And just see the distance that you've still got. So you've got a really nice magnification up here in the screen, but you've still got a nice working distance below. I reckon that's close to 2 inches that you've still got to work. You haven't got the stuck right down on what you're looking at. It would have perhaps been nicer to be able to go a little bit closer and increase the magnification, but I am still impressed by how close you can get. I say, looking at that wristwatch, if I show you the size of that index that we're actually looking at, if I zoom into that, you can see it's not a big target, but yet you get a nice magnification up on the display there, and it's nice and crisp. I mean, you can even see the little striations on that second hand as it goes by. Now, to show you some of the other features like sharpness and inverse image and that kind of thing, I'm gonna put a PCB under there. Okay, so I put a little PCB, it's a DC to DC converter in there. What I want you to note, just to get an understanding of your field of view on the work surface over here to what you see in the display, you can see the coil over there. So it's just from the one side of the coil, we've got that IC and then that capacitor. And if I bring you in, you can see, so that is just that little area over there. So it's actually a very small part of the kind of table over here that you get to view. Right, so now let me show you an interesting feature or things to be aware of with the lights. I've got both these lights focused on that IC. It's got some details written on that in text, obviously the date and the type of IC that it is, but you can't see it. And that's because of the way the light's on there. So if I just use my free hand and tilt that up, there we go. We suddenly get very clearly in view. We can see the text on there, but we cannot see it when I've got it lying flat on the table. But what we can do is I can tilt the whole scope back. So if I just pull it back on its arm, I can slip this forward so we get a bit of an angle. I bring things into focus and there you go. We now get that very nice clear text and you can see that on the IC. So I assume that's kind of what they're referring to when they talk about 3D. This tilting back and being able to see things from a different perspective definitely helps with the lighting. Also, you might want to get in at an angle to see something differently on the bench. It kind of, I suppose, might give you, I'd hate to call it 3D, I think that's a bit of a marketing term, but it does give you a different perspective. And as opposed to perhaps a very flat top view, you might get a better aspect if you can point this back. This arm can tilt right a long way back. So let me just do that and bring things into view. So if I tilt this right back and I bring this into view, I'm going to pop the camera up so you can see what I'm seeing. So what I've done, I've moved this device right. You can see I've actually moved it out of the light. So let me just change the lights. I had it initially over here. I've moved it right over here. And then I've tilted the arm of the microscope back. And because it's got that long focal range, I can still focus on it right down over there. And then you can see you get a different angle. And that certainly could be very helpful if you're trying to, say, not have just a straight top-down view, but view things at an angle. Okay, and just to try and give you a demonstration of what this can do, I've kind of zoomed in my camera over the top of this circuit board. And over here we've got a capacitor and next to it is a resistor. And this is basically what I can see with my eyes. So if I was trying to kind of get a closer look at actually seeing the text on top of that resistor or what have you, it would certainly be a challenge. I'd be pulling out my magnifying glass at this point in time. But if we come back and have a look at the display, that is what I'm zoomed into. So of course, this is with it right up. I'll just change the focus carefully, and again, it's fine enough. There's a little bit of slop in the adjustment, but not too much. I can fine enough, I can quite easily read what's going on there. So let me just shift this, and let's see how close we can get in. For one, we might want to be reading something on that resistor. We might want to inspect the soldering of this IC over there. You do have a digital zoom. So I'm just going to use the remote. So you can go, and I think it's 4 times. So if I push that, bang. So that is a digital zoom in, and certainly not much clarity has been lost. We'll go to the 4 times. Wow. So there you go. You know, normally digital zooms are a total mare, but that is not bad. That is getting going in, and we are getting a nice close view of that without too much pixelation, even though that is a digital zoom. Let's see how close we do the optical side. Come back out. So that's 2 times. That's back to normal. I'm going to drop the camera. So there we go. That's what I'm getting when I drop the camera right down to get it in close. I'll just move that so it is there. Now there's a handy feature here I'm going to show you. I'm just going to see what the digital zoom does for us there. Bang. And I must say, I'm reasonably impressed. So even with the digital zoom, we don't lose too much of the resolution. There's not a lot of pixelation, and it actually takes us in nice and close. Let's come back out. But that is not bad. Now you'll see that is inverted on the board, and I believe on the remote it's this blank button. If I push that, there we go, that is the rotate image. So right there, you could rotate the image if you wanted to see things the right way up. You can quickly rotate things. You've also got, you can take away the color. So there's a button on here. If I push that, it goes to black and white. And in some cases, you'll be able to see things better in black and white than with the color. The color can sometimes obscure some detail. So that, again, it's not a gimmicky feature. Actually, very handy to have, being able to switch between black and white and color. The other thing then is an inversion. Let's see, I think it's this button on the remote. Am I right? There we go. You get negative. And again, sometimes being able to change the contrast, you can pick up different detail when you invert the actual image. So like, for instance, these little dots over here, if you look at those dots on the image, those tend to disappear and aren't as obvious perhaps when you've got the darker color. But when you view the negative, again, certain details, certain things will pop out which won't when you've got the normal image. You've then got something called freeze mode menu. Let me get the wristwatch back under there, because that's going to be easier to show those. Now, obviously, you've got more functionality with the remote than actually using these buttons. These buttons on here, that takes a photograph. The OK starts and stops the video. That is your zoom feature, and that takes you to the menu, and that powers off. You can see on the display you've got your date and time, so at least you've got that when you're taking the video. You've got a timestamp over there. You've got some things on the top of the display. Standby is telling you whether you're running video or not. The microphone is not a feature on this. It tells you that you're in full HD. It then has also got a battery display. I reckon after looking at the menu system on this, this is actually whether it's the software and perhaps some of the hardware is geared towards a car camera. So taking a video in your camera in case you have an accident or what have you. Looking at the setup on the menu system, I think it was originally set up for that. It's also got a feature on here called, you can see this little X. You can actually put a set of cross lines up. So if I enable that, I use a remote, you can see you've got a pair of cross lines if you want to center something exactly. Another handy feature. There's also, let me just switch that off. You've got what it's called lines. So you can set these lines, and you can go to, I'm not going to do it now, it's fiddly, but you can go to each one of these settings. You can individually move these. You can change the thickness. You can change their color. So if you want to set up a grid and have a grid reference and change the width and the color and what have you, you can configure all of these grid lines to do that. Right, so then the other feature is, for instance, taking a snapshot. So if I just push this red button here or the button on the display, I've actually got the video running because I pushed the OK button. You can see it says up in the corner here, it actually is stating that it's recording. If I push the OK button, you can see it's in the standby mode. So now it's stopped recording. So that's as easy as it is to start your video and then stop your video. And what I'll do here, I'll actually insert the actual captured video as opposed to what you're seeing on the screen. So for one, the screen is nice and crisp, but you'll see that the actual video that it captures is nice and crisp as well. If you go and push the red button, that takes a snapshot. You'll just see very briefly the standby button just flashes, and that just takes a photograph. So again, for me in particular, if I'm analyzing or looking at wristwatches and I'm trying to see the mechanics of any slop or what have you in the hand and how things line up, this is a great tool for that. When we get to looking at some of the wristwatches and what have you, I'll show some of the challenges with when you've got this mechanical slop, if you're trying to set the time properly, or if you've got servos actually driving your hands and your second hand, how precise and nice those can be. And this device would be great for showing that off. The other thing on the remote, the one thing I cannot make head or tail of, this padlock, it says lock file. I've tried using that and I just haven't seen how it works. It says lock file, but it doesn't give an explanation as far as I can see. The other thing, you've got this little snowflake on the remote. So if I push that, it's going to freeze the display. It says image still. And again, that could be quite handy. I might want to freeze the image. For instance, if I'm looking at having the second hand in a certain position and I want to catch a photograph of it there, I can freeze the display and then I've got all the time, I assume. Can I take a picture? Yes, it's done a capture. So then I can capture that still image. Again, certainly initially you might think, well, why do you need that? If you're just looking at PCBs, you don't. But if you're looking at watches like this, bang, I can then unfreeze and then go to the live view. Right, and before we wrap it up, I just want to demonstrate again the digital zoom. So I've got you on here and I can tell you now, you're not quite seeing the nice contrast that I am with my own eyes. My camera, if I just change things a little bit because it was creating lines there, isn't even showing the crispness. But let's say, for instance, I wanted to take a closer look at this kind of hub with the second hands, minute and hour, to get a closer look at that. If I was to go and adjust everything, it's going to shake out and take things out of focus. Now, I could do that, but just look what the digital can do. So if I push here on the digital zoom, bang, right up, bang, we all remain in focus. Look how close I can get and the detail I can get, the kind of tool marks and striations on those hands. And it's not pixelating. I was thinking like the digital zoom would be a gimmick, but no, I'm impressed. It certainly provides some really handy functionality. Right, let's wrap it up. Right, so how do we summarize that? I am very impressed with what this device can do. It certainly fulfills my use case for it entirely, but I don't have another point of reference. It's the first time I've had a device like this. And I kind of sit here and go, wow, why didn't I have something like this on my bench before? Because it would have been really useful in previous videos to be able to film things, take a closer look at things, particularly for me with wristwatches, being able to film the movement and how well it works and the detail on the face. I find that intriguing and very useful. But it's very difficult for me to say, you should go out and grab this particular one, because I don't have another point of reference. And if you have a device like this on your bench, perhaps you've got a cheaper, more entry-level one around the $50 to $100 mark, and you know it can do as much, it's got the same size display and it's as crisp and clear, state that in the comments below. Or you may have one which is perhaps you think is superior for a little more money. Also, let us know, because I just do not have another point of reference. I say, I've been chuffed with this. I'm really pleased it was put into my hands. I'm going to feed back about the kind of focal distance that that arm could be longer. You could increase what you could see on the little tabletop if that arm was longer, because it's got a lot more focal range in there. It could be higher and you could see far more. And then you could bring it down if you wanted a closer view or to magnify. And that digital zoom, I'm really impressed. I think it works really well. So without having to fiddle, if I want to get closer, I can get in there. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers. Just a reminder that PCBWay is having a sale this Christmas. It continues right through to the 30th, and there are coupons available on their website.